On today's episode of The Unwritten Rule, we've got a bunch of Mizzou men's basketball updates for everybody, both in terms of potential future assets for the Tigers, as well as the very arena that Mizzou plays in. Got some physical updates there. A couple more bits of Mizzou news, then we'll do quick hits, and then we're going to finish the show with some movie talk. A little bit of a switch up, but there's a couple blockbusters out, so we're going to talk about those and where we think everyone should watch them in what order. So, a little bit of a switch up. We're going to end the show with some movie talk. Very fun show coming up for you guys. The Unwritten Rule starts right now.
Attention. Everybody stop what you're doing. It's time for The Unwritten Rule, a Mizzou sports podcast brought to you by the Believe Network, alongside Peyton Haverman and Kenny Van Doren. Here is your host, Jack Knowlton.
Welcome back to The Unwritten Rule. Today is Monday, July 24th, and Dennis Gates, Robin Pingeton, and Desiree Reed-Francois have commissioned an art project. That's right. The coaches slash AD at Mizzou have commissioned an art project inside of Mizzou Arena. The seats are turning black, Kenny and Peyton. The gold seats we know and love in Mizzou Arena that we sat in for four seasons, that many Tiger fans have sat in, you know, for many seasons before us, and I guess now not after us, or no more. They're going to turn black. That's the big news out of hoops we saw this week. I'll let you guys talk about the video. I know we all saw the wonderful little sketch they did to make this announcement, but this has been, kind of in the rumor mill, I think, for a little bit, along with the new video board that I believe was also confirmed. Guys, the Mizzou Arena seats turning black, new look for Mizzou Arena.
Yeah. We talked about this a while ago back when it was a rumor. I love it. The concept looks amazing. The video for it was fun. Dennis Gates said at the open practice the other day, this will be the last time people sit in the yellow seats and see that current scoreboard. I think it honestly, like, last season was such a big, big turnaround from the home crowd perspective. Like, it was the first time while we were there in our 4 years there that it really felt like the home crowd was a factor. Something about the black seats, I think, adds to the just mental aspect of it. It's not like it just looks more intimidating, you know. Blackouts in the arena are going to just go insane, I think. So a good change, I thought.
My favorite part of it is that they're keeping the block M in the student section. That was the one thing I was kind of worried about, because we didn't know that going into all those rumors we were reading. If that block M would stay there, you look at Froh Field, you've got the block M in the south end zone. It's great to
north
or in the north end zone. So I think it's fun to keep that block M in the student section there. It just looks sick. I mean, just looking at these pictures, like the last photo on the video that Mizzou Athletics tweeted, it just looks like a calm before the storm kind of photo with the full black seats. It's like, you know, blackout's coming. Alabama's coming in. You're gonna wear black to Alabama's funeral almost. And it just looks really cool to me. I thought the video was fun. They actually did paint the seatings. We saw a couple reporters who were there for that practice tweet a couple photos saying that Desiree Reed-Francois, Robin Pingeton, they actually painted them. Dennis also was in on that. And it was kind of a fun video all the way around.
They look tough, first and foremost, on that concept photo that was tweeted. It gives, like, way more, I think, of an intimidating vibe. The all black kind of dark seats. I don't know. There's something about it. And then, yeah, the video was hilarious. I love that there was a question of, yeah, did they actually go paint the seats, or was it just part of the bit? The video was hilarious. The texting exchange between Dennis and Robin Pingeton. It made me wonder how. If you guys have any thoughts on how Dennis Gates actually texts people, like, do you think it's as robotic as sometimes we see him with, like, media and in certain situations? Like, I wonder what his texts say.
I think it's wise. I think he's probably wise and perfect grammar would be my guess. He seems like a perfect grammar texter.
I think when he found out they were black seats too, he's like, it's a blank canvas. You know, it's all black. We paint it with our color of style of basketball, the way we score, the way we are with our culture that we're building in this program. It's like a blank canvas. And that, like, the M in the student section is what the students do.
It's our tradition.
The rest of it It's our tradition. We leave our mark on the rest of these seats. They might look black here, but we're going to paint our story on these seats.
If Dennis had his way, every seat would have one of the 8 core values engraved on it. And it would just say, like, oh, I'm in the friendship seat.
I got the love seat.
I'm in the accountability seat. Boo. Whatever 8 core value you hate the most. But yeah, it looks sweet. And then, yeah, that practice, too, just to you know, finish out with that. Like, I obviously, none of us were there, but I saw some highlights. First of all, I'll bring the attention to saw a pretty nice block by Jordan Butler. He like blocked Noah Carter twice. I saw that on Ben Arnett for KOMU tweeted that video out, and there seemed also just like a good amount of fans there. Those were the only two thoughts I had or things I saw. But if you have any thoughts on the practice,
I saw Vanover kind of had a few nice moments there. Ankle Bully Ant had a few highlight reels. It seemed like I know Nick Honor said Caleb Grill's going to be the best shooter in the country. So probably just all around good stuff you want to hear.
My two quick things. We've mentioned this before that we do have a group chat, just some of the guys who were really big into the basketball team the last couple of years. And Peyton sent a photo from one of the practices of all the players kind of huddled up. And he said, spot Connor Vanover, tallest guy on the court, biggest guy on the court. My second thing is this tweet that Dave Matter put out there. I'll read the whole tweet for you. Gates believes Caleb Brown can be the Trago Million of this year's team. In quote marks, he's a great defender, great connector. He wants fans and media to give him a fair shot and not just be known as Kobe's brother. He said that before. I think even, Jack, you asked him a question in a press conference before that he kind of got a reaction from about, you know, he's, you know, speak for your own. You're not just Kobe's brother. You're Caleb.
Yeah. Yeah, I had to take. I think that was Dave Matter. I won't put him on the spot.
Okay.
I think that one was Dave. I got the Muhammad Diarra Mo Diarra distinction. That was me. But yeah, we did have to learn our sort of lingo with Dennis. But that is a good sign that, you know, if he is going to maybe find a role, obviously, like, you know, he was in the portal, right? Wasn't it UTEP?
UTSA
or UTSA? Yeah. That's right. And then, you know, he decided to come back. There you go. But yeah, I think that's good if he can find some sort of role. I want to stay. We'll do the show me squad in a minute, but I want to stay in Dennis's realm because he is obviously still making waves in recruiting in addition to these big personnel changes. Oh, do we know anything about the Jumbotron style or anything like that? Or we
don't
just know it's a new one?
Like, okay. It's just new.
I'm reiterating what I know I've said before, which is I want what they have in the Mercedes-Benz Stadium, where it's just the circle, the giant circle Jumbotron. You can see it from every angle. I think that'd be sick if they can pull that off in tiny Mizzou Arena comparatively.
I think if you did pull that off, you're kind of losing the windows almost.
Probably.
And even like the jerseys up there. So, I mean, you can't like put, you know, more jerseys up there. I know Drew Smith, he's going to have one up there one day. Mark Smith, even I think all the Smiths should be up there. Just make some room. There's a couple glue guys from that Conzo era that might get up there as well. But jokes aside, I don't know if it'll fit.
Yeah, but no, you definitely couldn't do it. Also, that one thing on the windows. Watching a day basketball game with windows and the light is shining on the court is one of the most surreal things I think I've experienced. Because I'm not used to an arena like that.
And it bothers opposing fans, so that makes it even better.
That I'll embrace. Yeah, that I can get behind.
Well, what about like some of those 4 o'clock, you know, Saturday games? You walk in, you know, during the winter, you come out and it's snowing and it's dark outside. You're like, I just want to go to sleep.
That makes me tired. I'm like, I walked in, it was daytime. I was at this arena for like 12 hours. That's what it feels like. I don't know. It's a hit or miss, but you're right. It does bother opposing fan bases, so that's fine. So I'm staying on the recruiting trail for Mizzou men's basketball, because in addition to obviously the arena stuff, Dennis is still out here, recruiting. Missouri landed in the top 8 for a 2024 guy that they've been linked to, I think for some time, small forward Annor Boateng, small forward class of 2024. I mean, I feel like it's becoming a broken record where we have rather of us naming, you know, more prospects that Dennis is linked to. But if you guys have anything on Boateng,
only thing I know about Boateng, it does seem like he's one of the staff's bigger targets for that year. They probably would feel pretty good about where they're at. Just everything we've heard around him is positive. Would have to it's tough to pry him away from Arkansas, especially with Musselman there. He's a great recruiter, but Dennis is too. So I would give Mizzou a very good shot at that.
Pretty fire top eight graphic, you know, the Arkansas, Auburn, Georgia Tech, Indiana, LSU, Mizzou, Ohio State, and Virginia Tech. But he's got the little boat, you know, the little yachty graphic, and he put himself on the boat. So he's really leaning into his last name. That was probably like the most fun thing out of all of it.
The boat. That'd be a fun nickname. Fit in with Noah Carter. Maybe he'll get the Noah's Ark.
I don't think they would overlap.
You're right. He'd be gone.
I don't know if Noah Carter has any more eligibility. Well,
they'd have good segment material. You could go from Noah's Ark to the Boateng boat.
There you go.
Easy. Good stuff from Mizzou Twitter. But yeah, I remember hearing his name come up a lot for Mizzou over the past couple months. So this seems like a guy, like Peyton said, that the staff seems pretty keen on staying in for. The other one we saw, 2025 guy this time. So Dennis is still Dennis is looking even long term at his roster. We know he likes to rebuild. He always says he's constantly recruiting. He thinks every player is gonna leave, and he thinks, you know, he's gonna land every target he gets, which is a good mentality. That said, Efeosa Oliogu, I think I got it. 2025 small forward from Toronto has been linked to the Tigers, and he's gonna visit October 7th and 8th. So, you know, another guy maybe down the pipeline for Dennis, if you guys know anything more about him.
I don't know a lot other than he's very highly ranked. That's kind of a similar track to how Mizzou kind of recruited T.O. Barrett. As soon as you were able to talk to 24 guys, they were in on him. They got him on campus early. He didn't take another visit. He took to Mizzou, that is. He took another visit to Oklahoma. But after that, I mean, Mizzou locked him up early. So maybe they're on a similar timeline. It's just very refreshing to see Mizzou in on so many guys like this. I mean, in 24 and 25, especially when you think a few years ago, I mean, Mizzou had a recruiting class of Jordan Wilmore. That's it. So
that says a lot. That says mm-hmm. a lot.
Huge, and just so much better quality at this point.
And Jordan Wilmore's only Power 5 offer was from Konzo Martin. Also looking at some of these other things for Efeosa, that Mizzou visit's coming October 7th through 8th. The first one is going to be at Maryland on September 8th through the 10th. When you look at the On3 Elite, looking at the recruiting prediction machine, Maryland has a 45.4% to land Efeosa. The Tigers are right behind at 39.7. So definitely the two teams in the running. Fifth ranked shooting guard in the country, according to On3. I mean, that's massive. You'll see a lot of college basketball players, you know, lower it down to just, you know, teams like Maryland and Mizzou and not really go to places like Duke, Kentucky, where they might not be the number one option. So this could be a big splash, and a guy who could probably, you know, see the court right away whenever he's a freshman, wherever he goes, especially at 6'5", 200.
Yeah, that is impressive. The measurables. Number one player in Ontario. So maybe a Maple Mamba RJ Barrett situation could line up for Mizzou. So yeah, seems like someone Dennis is clearly keeping an eye on, and yeah, we'll see how that visit goes. October 7th and 8th, Efeosa will be on campus to visit the Tigers. Last thing I have basketball wise, switching over to the former Tigers now, the Show Me Squad. They're out of the TBT, unfortunately. We said we talked about them. They won their first game, beat the UNLV team, and then they faced in what is obviously the most anticipated version of the Border War, which is the two TBT teams. They played, is it Mass Street? That's what their Kansas is, TBT. And they lost. I wasn't able to watch. I don't know if you guys were. I saw they came back. Mizzou did, though. They seemed like they were down big early and then came back. But if you guys have anything, but yeah, the boys sadly did not get it done in the Border War TBT battle.
Definitely really slow out of the gates, only 11 points in that first quarter, but that third quarter is where they responded. I mean, I was just kind of scoreboard watching. I didn't have the time to really sit down and watch this game, but losing 69-65 to a team with a very deep team. We talked about this last time we were on here. I thought, you know, the depth would be an issue. DeAndre Golston finally saw some action. He played 4 minutes, didn't take a shot. I don't know if that was actually DeAndre Golston.
Wow.
Or,
yeah. Hold on.
But the big winner, you know, for this Mizzou team, in my opinion, just from these two games, Eric Neal. We mentioned him before. He was the leading scorer last time out. Wasn't the leading scorer this time. Of course, Isaiah Mosley dropped 25. He had a great TBT, great response after kind of a sloppy first quarter, really pieced everything together. You know, this team could really do something in the future, maybe get some more guys with former NBA experience. Mario Chalmers was on the bench for Kansas. He didn't play in the game, probably just kind of like a last option if they really need him. But there's guys out there that Mizzou could probably bring into this down the road. But kind of a good finish there from the Tigers.
Yeah, that's promising. Did the Morris brothers play for Kansas?
They're the coach and the assistant coach. I don't even think they played in the first one.
Okay.
And
okay.
I believe Phil Pressey was actually at this game now. So
oh, nice.
Luce was the head coach in the first game, and then Phil Pressey returned because he posted some photos of him coaching on the sideline.
Oh, nice. I think that'd be good practice. I mean, if you're, you know, you're taking a role on the Celtics, you might as well get a little bit of experience beforehand. The only other thing I saw from this game was Jackson Francois. Fired up Jackson Francois. He tweeted, like, fix your refs at TBT. So
he was
a little bit upset with the officiating on the court.
Talker mess, man. I would never expect that from him.
Yeah, a little bit fiery.
Yeah.
He's sticking up for his boys, DeAndre and Ben Sternberg.
Ben didn't get to play in this
and
one,
Isaiah Mosley.
I'm glad we got to see the friend of the show in the first game.
That is nice, and yeah, shout out Jackson. I got that as a like recommended tweet. That was the one tweet they picked to recommend me when I woke up one morning. Was just, hey, check out what Jackson Francois tweeted. And it's just in all lowercase letters, fix UR refs at TBT. It's like, all right, thanks
Jackson. Sounds like him.
Thanks for your opinion. Nice. And then only other Mizzou item we saw is the golf team has a new leader. Glen Millican from New Mexico led the Lobos to 8 appearances in the NCAA championship, 22 seasons at New Mexico. That's what I was reading about him. So he's been around for a while, but he's leading Mizzou golf. They've obviously had some good performers. Peyton, who's the guy on tour? There's one guy almost on tour.
Yeah, I can't think of it. I was trying to think of him, and I literally just was Googling it as you find it, and I can't. Hayden Buckley,
yeah,
is the big standout guy. Make him the head coach.
There you go. Yeah.
I don't know enough about golf. We should have friend of the show that has never been on the show, Chad Sylvie, come on and talk about it. But
there you go. Yeah, that's just shout out. I was just trying to remember Hayden Buckley because I know he always pops up like whenever there's a
whenever he's doing well in the tournament.
Yeah, he does. He has like a good round one, and then Gabe Darmond will tweet like one
Gabe
thing.
And Dave like, oh. Whoa. And Callum, like, whoa.
But yeah, there you go. Mizzou golf, new leader, 22 seasons at New Mexico. So plenty of experience to come for golf. But yeah, in summary, new seats, fellas. We're in the, it is July 23rd news, but you know, new seats in Mizzou Arena is that'll get everyone hyped. Dennis painting a chair. I really wish he wrote friendship or something on the chair in the video. It would have been so funny. But yeah, with that, we will segue over to Quick Hits. Okay, quick hits time. Kenny, jerseys of the
weekend. Former Mizzou running back Damarea Crockett signed a deal with the New York Jets, and I got his. Of course, we don't have an edit of him in a Jets jersey or him in a Jets jersey.
Could
yet.
Make one.
But I just went with the Mizzou one. I'm not making any more of those.
I might make one.
It takes so much time. So I got him in the old gold number 16 with the matte black helmet. That's where he got for this week.
Only been in the league 4 years. Feels like he's been in it for 20. But yeah, that's a good one. My jersey of the week, Adam Wainwright, Team USA. Gentlemen, get your war paint on. Adam Wainwright is going back to battle. He is being activated off the IL, and he will start on Monday for the St. Louis Cardinals. He dodged my Chicago Cubs. But yeah, he is doing really well this year, and they're going to give him the proper send-off.
Very nice. My jersey of the week, I'm actually going with a hat. the hat of Brian Harman, who had a Megacorp hat. I've never heard of Megacorp. I believe they're some sort of like insurance company when I very quickly Googled them, a logistics company. But Brian Harman won the Open Championship at Royal Liverpool, the American, his first major title coming in the Open. Pretty exciting stuff for him. Congrats to him first and foremost. But I just thought a hat that just said Megacorp, like that seems like a very like, you know, in a bad movie, that's what you'd see some like the evil company is just called Megacorp. They don't have they don't have a real name. It's just Megacorp. I thought that was
I was thinking it was like from some like TV show. Like I was like, I feel like I've heard of Megacorp. I was like, is that those are the bad guys in Dodgeball? Like I just couldn't remember.
Globo Gym.
Globo Gym. Like
Mega Mind.
Mega Mind. There you go.
Mega Mind. Or I know, yeah, next you're gonna see like what's the one in Fairly Odd Parents? Dimsdale? Doug Dibidome.
Yeah.
There you go. There you go. One guy. He's gonna have one next. Mm-hmm. There you go. Spelling Bee.
I want to go back real quick to Peyton's to his jersey of the weekend. I wanted to just compare his stats if he didn't pitch this season and just went out with Albert Pujols and Yadier Molina. How much of a difference do you think it's taken on his ERA this season, Peyton? He's made 11 starts and he has a 7.66 ERA. How much do you think it changed his career ERA by doing this?
0.30.
.08. So
not as big.
Yeah, I thought it'd be a lot worse. He is still two wins away from that 200 mark. I think that's what he's really fighting for.
Moving on.
All right. So, Spelling Bee. This week I'm going with the U.S. Women's National Team. And I found out this last night that Dennis Rodman's daughter plays for the U.S. Women's team, Trinity Rodman.
Yep.
I heard from my cousins who are big soccer fans that she is top five on the team, and she's very young.
Yeah, she's good. She's good.
She's made 19 appearances this year, born in 2002, May 20th. So she's 21 years old right now, still young, still hunting for the prime. But we're going to start off with Trinity Rodman, and Peyton's going to go first since Jack might know these names a little bit better.
T-R-I-N-I-T-Y. R-O-D-M-A-N.
There you go. Next name, Lynn Williams.
First of all, shout out the U.S. 3-0 over Vietnam. I was watching some of this game. They were struggling at the beginning. Alex Morgan missed a penalty. I was getting a little worried. But Lynn Williams, I believe, spells it L-Y-N-N-W-I-L-L-A-M-S.
There you go. All right,
you
Peyton.
Forgot the I-A-M-S, but...
I-A-M-S. Yeah. My bad. Williams.
Third name is for Peyton, Andy Sullivan.
Andy Sullivan. A-N-D. You could be tricking me here. I'm going to say
No. Don't look at Jack.
No one watched the YouTube. No one watched the YouTube.
He's watching it.
I'm looking at my computer screen. A-N-D-I.
Uh-huh. Yep.
S-U-L-L-I-V-A-N.
Sullivan. Correct.
Jack, for the sweep, Christy Mewis.
Oh, I hope you get it.
Is she related to someone? They had a Samantha Mewis for a while. I wonder if she's related. I have no idea. Christy can be spelled an awful lot of ways.
She's the younger sister of Samantha Mewis.
Samantha Mewis. Can I do the last name first?
Yeah.
I think Mewis is just M-E-W-I-S. IS.
Correct.
Oh, gosh, Christy. C?
Nope.
Oh, K-K-R-I-S-T.
I must have forgot the part where it's his turn.
EY? Yeah.
Nope, not EY. Peyton.
Crap.
K-R-S-K-R-I-S-T-I.
Oh, you guys are both wrong. It's K-R-I-S-T-I-E. Christy.
Dang it.
There's too many ways to spell Christy.
Yeah. That's why I went with that one. You guys went 3-for-4. Good week there. Best beats of the week right now. I'm going with the first preseason game. This is the Hall of Fame game this year. I got Jets plus 100 on the money line against the Browns. I have no idea who's going to win this game. I have no idea who's going to be the primary quarterback. Do we even know where Demarai
Crockett's going to play?
Like, be with this team for a week before this game starts. Mm-hmm. But I'm taking the Jets plus 100. I'm taking the underdog. Right now, the Browns opening at minus 120. I don't like Deshaun Watson, so I guess that's another reason not to choose the Browns.
Not going to play.
Can we? Can we add him?
That's what I'm saying. I don't even know who's going to be the quarterback primarily in the first.
Can we
quarter
add him
even.
To the? Can I add him to the banned list?
Yes.
Can you join?
Watson is officially banned.
Yeah, officially banned. It's him,
Zach Hampel. I forget who else.
And
Peter Camp and Chase Madison. Because
those two, and then also the kids that bullied
Ball's daughter. Yeah, they're banned. Yeah.
All right, Deshaun Watson banned, mm-hmm. not allowed on the show. Good bet, Kenny.
We talked about it a little bit already. My beat of the week: the USA is plus odds to win the FIFA World Cup. That is the easiest bet I'll ever make in my life. USA plus 225. They're gonna walk through this tournament. We're the best.
Yeah, they did, like I said, look shaky against Vietnam in the first game, but it does not matter. USA, baby. Yeah, we got to win. I will be watching. I was away from sports this weekend, but I will be watching with great intrigue the rest of this World Cup, because, yeah, they need to bring it home. My best beat, I tried this team last time and it didn't work. I am in a hole for betting. Kenny read my record off air before we started, and I think, like, I don't think I've hit a bet in probably like four or five shows. So I really could use this. I'm going baseball because Kenny took the only NFL preseason game. There weren't other lines available. I'm picking my team again, the Crew, minus 112 against the Reds tomorrow back home at Miller Park. They had a rough series against Atlanta. But, you know, I think I don't want to, I won't say anything about Contreras, but because I'll save that for Peyton. But, yeah, go Crew. Please help me get out of this hole. I need a win. I need a win back.
The Reds haven't won five in a row or anything.
looking back at these beats, though, Jack,
streaks
the last
are made
time
to be
you,
snapped.
The last time you won came the 17th of July. So it wasn't that long ago.
Okay.
Nearly a week ago.
Last week.
Bad. Yeah. So.
Well, it feels like way longer. I feel like every bet I'm actually, there's that pick a couple where I'm like, you know, kind of a toss-up for me, but the ones I feel like I'm like, yeah, I'm confident in this, never hit. So
that was when we were betting on not Wimbledon, but I think it was the Swedish Open.
Oh, nice. Yeah,
so
I know Swedish
betting,
Open.
Yeah, we were just betting on games we weren't watching, matches we weren't watching. So the record right now, Peyton, or I am in first place at 10-5. Peyton is in second at 7-7. Peyton making a good charge right now. It's his last couple bets. And then Jack, you're at 5-9. You guys both have two futures right now.
That's what I was going to say. Sorry to interrupt you, Kenny. That came up, though. Jimmy Garoppolo like had an update this week.
Yeah, yours is not looking
mine
good.
Is not hitting. Mine is not hitting. Because my future was Jimmy Garoppolo to not start for the Raiders week one. And I think he's now cleared to already join the team for training camp. So we might as well cross that one off.
Unless he gets hurt somehow.
Yeah.
In preseason. And then Peyton, your future was it? Did you take LeSean McCoy to take over for Shannon Sharp?
Yes. I believe. Okay. No, I took Michael Irvin.
Michael Irvin. That is right. Yeah. And he's still working for ESPN at the moment, right? He wasn't part of the layoffs.
I have no idea.
Yeah.
I don't.
There were a lot of
layoffs.
All right. Dirty Birds of the Weekend.
I heard a great take. Speaking of that Skip Bayless should just debate like 9-year-olds that have really hot takes about sports the whole time.
It's like that one YouTube video of those guys sitting at the table. Like,
yeah,
like,
yes.
Discussing sports.
Like the kids. And they're they look all serious. Debate. They're wearing like the Under Armour Curry like sweatshirt or whatever. Yeah.
I could see them doing that.
Oh, yeah.
All right. Dirty Birds of the Weekend. Starting off. Right here. Peyton and I can kind of go in and out on this one. We had to take another Cardinal, though. I took Genesis Cabrera last weekend. He is no longer a Cardinal. He is now a Blue Jay. So,
Still a bird.
So he can come back anytime he wants. But Wilson Contreras, he's on the trade block. A guy who kind of struggled to play his own position this season. The one he's been paid millions of dollars to play at catcher ended up going to play some left field, some DH, brought him back to playing catcher. There were rumors out there that he was calling pitches that the pitcher didn't even have. So it was kind of a messy situation there, but now he's on the trade block. A reunion in Chicago, a Cubs team that's really hot right now that could use a
my
second
dirty
catcher.
Bird of the week. Elon Musk
I just want to throw out William better. William Contreras better.
Well, yeah, but that's just obvious. But no, we might as well rename this segment the "What Did Wilson Contreras Do This Weekend?" because it seems like he's on this show a lot, and it's never not deserved. Like, he earns it every time. But just moving on, we got to get our one Cardinals jab in at least.
Yeah, I was gonna say we could also rename the segment just the Cardinals jab segment for the rest of baseball season.
Yeah, but my dirty bird. Twitter, Elon Musk announced today that Twitter is going to be no more. The bird logo will be gone. X.com now links to Twitter.com. They're going to rename Twitter X. Just the letter. The logo will just be the letter. There will be no blue bird.
Do we know what font?
No, we don't know anything yet. Elon Musk will be going live later today. He tweeted that at noon. 45 so
noon 45
we'll be seeing that logo soon, I'd presume.
Interesting. I hope they'd make it in like Comic Sans, like that's the font they pick. It just looks stupid.
I hope it is like an XD.
I'm pretty sure there's a released image, like if you
is there.
I have one saved on our Twitter account right now for the Dirty Birds of the
you
weekend.
Mean our X account
for our what account our X account our X whoa account. Sorry. Mm-hmm. Careful. Don't take me off air there.
Yeah, Eric, Elon.
If you want to look at it right now?
We could tweet it or whatever.
I mean, it's gonna get tweeted at some point. I mean, you're gonna see it.
Yeah, I guess you'll see it. Yeah, we don't need to describe it. There you go.
Also, if people aren't, you'll see it.
You'll see it. It's like it's normally we were thinking the right thing where it's like, yeah, we got to tweet photos of stuff for people to see it, but this is the special case. Everyone will see this photo.
And Jack will throw it up on the screen there. If you watch on YouTube, he'll show you it.
I just did.
I just put it in the Google Doc for you guys to see.
Oh, that looks so stupid.
It looks awesome.
It looks like a video game.
It looks terrible.
It looks so stupid.
Moving on.
My dirty bird of the week. Bird noises. Found an article on the New York Times. Can you understand bird? ? Test your recognition of calls and songs. This must be what they got rid of their sports page to fill with content.
Sports page?
No, they got rid of it.
You not heard about this?
I did not know that.
They laid off their whole
all of their sports page.
For the Athletic.
Yep.
Well, there goes my dream job.
Perfect time to wiggle your way in there. They have no employees.
Oh, but Peyton, maybe you can write about bird noises. So this article, can you understand bird? Test your recognition of calls and songs. So it goes through a bunch of birds, and it's like you have to guess what the birds are saying. So for example, you can listen to a call by white-headed woodpeckers. I'll demonstrate the call. And it says, can you guess what they're saying? And the options are go away, this is mine, and I'm hungry. So
that's nice interactive article. That's a go away.
I'll guess. Nope, the answer was I'm hungry. So
fat bird.
Like the country.
I am hungry.
The nation.
Where DeAndre Golston's playing?
We've had way too many mentions of hungry.
A lot of hungry.
Like in
a lot
the
of
last
hungry.
Month.
If anyone from Hungary is,
we're gonna build up a base.
If anyone from Hungary DMs the Twitter account, I'll Venmo you $2. There you go.
You're gonna have to change that. The currency though, right?
Yeah, to euros, but
you're gonna give them some euros.
All right, I'll give you 2 euros because that's actually less than 2 American.
The
dollars.
Food? You're gonna give them 2 of those euros? Okay.
Yep.
I think the Mizzou J School should really think about paying for that New York Times subscription. I know a lot of these students use it, but after that article, I'd be wary if I want to pay the next month of it, the next $1 for the next 6 months or whatever the deal is this week.
No more sports.
Yeah.
Peyton, best thing you learned.
Best thing I learned this week, Nick Bolton, can I get a big ol' MIZ? Probably the best player we saw while we were there from 19 to 23 on the football team. Speaking with the media today, Chiefs head coach Andy Reid called Nick Bolton's quality play a nod to the University of Missouri. The direct quote was, he's a tribute to the University of Missouri. So people are saying MIZ, others ZOU. Clearly it's where champions are developed. Andy Reid, of course, coached here. Nick Bolton went here. Kendall Blanton, almost said World Series, Super Bowl champ 2 years ago. Where did he go, guys?
Mizzou!
Actually, no, he went to San Angelo State, but he did. No, he went here. I'm scrolling. But, yeah, so that was just a fun thing, seeing Nick Bolton, Nick Bolton's incredible play be attributed to his time at Mizzou.
That is beautiful.
PJ Green, who tweeted that from Fox 4 Kansas City, I've sat in front of him before in a press conference. Just realized that I didn't know who he was until now. I didn't even know his name. He was at the K-State Mizzou game. The only reason I remember this is because the room was like smaller than my bedroom right now, and we were like all on top of each other. And I was like, this guy's right behind me. He's asking good questions. I'll remember him.
So good journalism.
Good job. Yeah, good journalism there from PJ Green. He played football in college. Ooh. Looking at his bio right now.
Cool.
In Greenville, Tennessee.
I was just going to say, too, that like that his fumble recovery and his scoop and score in the Super Bowl is like up there with some of my favorite, like one of my favorite Super Bowl memories. I just was like losing my mind on the couch watching that. What?
Go ahead. I was just going to say it was the only thing that made me leave my seat for that.
Oh, yeah. It was just so fun. I had my Nick Bolton. I bought a Nick Bolton shirt from like the Players Association because it was really cheap. I had that on and I was hyped. I was hyped for our guy. Anyway, Kenny, go ahead.
Best thing I learned this week, actually going back to the Nick Bolton thing, I just remembered that play is in the quarterback documentary on Netflix, too. They show it in the last episode during the Super Bowl. Best thing I learned this
week. Going back to the Nick Bolton. I'm just kidding.
this is a tweet from Awful Announcing, a clip from The Herd on Fox Sports 1. Colin Cowherd and Jason McIntyre have an entire conversation about trading draft picks for Shohei Ohtani, which you can't do in Major League Baseball. Oh, my goodness. You know, it's terrible. They're talking about players.
You can trade competitive balance picks, but yes, not the picks they're talking about. They're talking about just straight, like, first rounders.
Exactly. And it was funny. He was like, give me your number one prospect, your number two prospect, your number three prospect. He was like, you want a first round pick too? He's like, yeah, if I can get it, throw it in there. It was just terrible. I mean, I just don't know how you talk about sports your whole life and have no idea that you can't do that.
It reflects poorly on them, and it reflects just as bad on the producers for not getting in Colin Cowherd and Jason McIntyre's ear and going,
stop it. You can't trade those picks. Stop talking about trading the picks. Stop.
How did one of them not come out of there and rip the microphone out of Colin Cowherd's face?
Yeah. Wow. Colin Cowherd is bad. I'm stunned. Stunned.
Well, he has a bad history with baseball in general. Google Colin Cowherd ESPN exit for more information on that.
Ooh, there you go. A little rabbit hole to go on. My best thing I learned this weekend, Lionel Messi lived up to all of the hype and build up to his debut with Inter Miami. He scored the game-winning goal for Miami at the very, very tail end of the game. He got subbed in, came on. There was 21,000 sold-out crowd in that stadium. Whipped up into a frenzy when he scored one of his trademark free kicks. I just think it's pretty cool. It was fun seeing on Twitter all the celebrities that were there. There was like everyone from like Tom Brady, Patrick Mahomes, like all these famous athletes. Kim K, I think, was there. You know, ton of names to watch the GOAT. And yeah, he lived up. He scored on his debut. And you know, Inter Miami, who suck, by the way. Maybe they won't suck if he keeps playing like this. But yeah, good job, Messi. You made a lot of Apple TV money with that goal, and I hope you went and got a nice pub sub to celebrate.
I don't even know anything about soccer, but that clip was so cool. Like it gave me chills. Like
it's pretty cool. I mean, I don't want to understate. I'm a little bit soccer pretentious. I don't like MLS. It's not a good league, so I don't watch it. But it is a very, very big moment. I don't want to understate that. Like this is the greatest player to ever play the game, doing it in a country that is trying to grow it. So it's important. And yeah, Peyton, like the other clip I saw is like everyone was like going crazy and celebrating. He ran like straight to his kids and just like gave him a hug. Just humble king, humble goat. But yeah, go Messi. Congrats on that nice goal.
Yeah, he gave a big hug to LeBron as well. I mean, those are two of the greatest athletes of all time right there. One thing that really stood out to me is that he signed his jersey and then gave it to Kim Kardashian's son. That was the one thing I was just like, it's kind of weird. You know, you could have given it to another kid who was out there that's not going to be a billionaire his whole life.
Who probably could just buy one.
Yeah, like that jersey's just going to get tossed in the back of his closet. Like, he's not going to care. I mean, it was kind of a gross moment. And this game was also a friendly. I mean, it doesn't count.
Yeah, it doesn't. But, so. I mean, it's cool to see. But, hey, maybe Kim K's kid will grow up and be a big soccer
He's
guy.
A billionaire.
Maybe that'll inspire.
And he doesn't do anything. You could have given it to an actual person that cared.
He couldn't control who he was born to.
Maybe I'm not mad at him. I'm mad at Messi. Maybe, I think Messi could give it to someone else.
Maybe the son asked really, really nicely for it.
Here's a quote. Give me that shirt, Messi. So that's a quote straight from him. No, it's not a quote. Why would he actually say that?
Claim that is
I didn't actually think it was a quote, Kenny.
Are you guys ready for my joke? I'm like itching to tell this one.
Not really, but go ahead.
Okay, here we go. So, all right, picture this, guys. A bear, like the animal, big grizzly bear, walks into a bar and says, "Give me a whiskey and cola." And the bartender then asks, "Why the big pause?" And the bartender says that. And then the bear just shrugs and says, "I'm not sure. I was born with them."
Peyton, your face got really red during that.
Oh my god, dude. I was so ready to tell this joke. I think it is a knee slapper. I think it is the funniest thing I have ever said on the show.
Are you slapping your table?
Stop hitting your table. My ears are ringing. God.
That's the joke of the week. We didn't have a ratio.
I can come back with it. That was a good one. I've actually never heard that one before.
You guys get it?
Yes, he's big paws.
Yes, but did you get why he said the big paws part?
Yes.
Yeah, because he seemed to pause.
He said whiskey and cola. Because he paused. That's such a good joke. Oh my god. I'm gonna
good joke,
actually.
All right, last segment.
We're done here. All right, with that resounding comedic genius from Peyton, we will shift over and close out with a little movie talk. Okay, we're gonna finish the show with a little movie talk. You know, like I said, we are in the you know, dog days of summer. It's late July. We are reporting on seats changing colors. That's our main Mizzou news at the moment. We are gonna have fall camp soon though, so we'll have plenty of football stuff in August. But we thought we'd do some movie talk because there's a bunch of big blockbusters out right now, two of which just came out this Friday. We had Barbie and Oppenheimer. Is Barbenheimer the word everyone's using?
Yes.
Combine them all. Those both came out. I'm very, very excited to see both of them. I love Oppenheimer. I don't know. You guys have any thoughts on just the movies in general before we rank these? The third one then is the new Mission Impossible movie. So we're going to pick the order in which you should see them from 1 to 3. I have some thoughts on this, but do you guys have any thoughts on just the movies first and foremost?
Haven't seen Barbie and Oppenheimer yet. I will be seeing Oppenheimer this weekend. I've heard nothing but good things. I saw Mission Impossible yesterday. Absolutely cinema. It's just so much fun. I love the Mission Impossible movies, and the last two that have come out have been like, mwah.
Tom Cruise saved movies.
Mm-hmm. I agree.
And it's gonna be weird now too, because we have this this strike with the writers, so we don't know what like movies we're even gonna get.
I'll get in there and fix it myself before I let Dead Reckoning Part 2 come out late. That movie needs to come out on time immediately.
I'm personally the most excited for Oppenheimer too, because and any friends of the show will know this because I'll talk about him to anyone who will listen. I am a huge Cillian Murphy fan. He is the best.
Not enough great to actor. Say his name right, apparently.
His name is... That's how you say his name. I've been trolled with this like several times with the Cillian Silly. It's Cillian. But yeah, love Peaky Blinders. He's in the Batmans. A couple other things. Inception. But I'm excited for Oppenheimer the most.
So I haven't seen any of the three yet, but I'm doing some calculations at the moment. the total runtime of all three movies together is 7 minutes or 7 hours and 37 minutes. Sorry, I was reading right to left. So I'm kind of, you know, trying to block away like which ones I would go to see first, you know, just thinking about it. You know, of course, the longest one is Oppenheimer. Mm-hmm. It's a 3 hour movie just to see a bomb blow up. So that's a long time. If you, you know, pull out your phone and put something underneath, you could watch two things at once. So I'm kind of thinking maybe you get the pirated version of Mission Impossible and start it halfway through Oppenheimer, pause it the last like 15 minutes whenever the bomb goes off. I don't even know, I haven't seen the movie. But
this proposal is a crime to watching movies.
So I think the first one that I would go with here, I guess you guys said it perfectly about these movies, but I would say the first one I would go with is Mission Impossible. You know, get your feet wet, get some action, you know, get yourself going,
fire yourself up, man.
Fire yourself up. You got to start early. You're starting early.
I said this earlier. I said I walked out of Mission Impossible and a part of me just wanted to go see another movie right after that. I wanted to see Oppenheimer right after.
So perfectly to just start it off in the morning, you know, 8 o'clock. That's when it starts. I would say you get one large bucket of popcorn, three coffees to keep yourself awake.
Jesus.
But if you have stomach problems like me, maybe two. I mean, I've been known to have stomach problems with coffee, so maybe two for you.
Try anything.
So anything.
Yeah, Kenny just can't eat.
Even the butter. I mean, the butter from the popcorn can get you going. But after that, you know, you're just like so much shooting and action. What could just make you feel better as a person? Barbie. But I've heard that it's emotional. It's emotional at the end, the last 15 minutes, get kind of emotional, especially for the Ken character. So maybe you're kind of feeling sad a little bit. You know what could really make you better when you're feeling sad? Something boring. 3 hours of waiting for a person to blow up a bomb, jump into Oppenheimer, and you'll be excited at the end. I've heard that the bomb goes.
Do you actually think Oppenheimer's going to be boring?
I've heard it is.
The people you heard that from, do you hear that from TikTok?
People will watch 7 second videos and have no attention span.
It's 3 hours and then the bomb goes off at the end. Isn't this a movie about communists? Aren't these guys communists?
No,
these are communists,
dude. You stink.
Yeah, boo.
That's where I'm going there. I got Mission Impossible, Barbie, Oppenheimer. That's
wouldn't you maybe want to get that out of the way first, then?
Yeah, why wouldn't you want to watch Oppenheimer first?
Why would you want to just be like, oh.
Because it'll put you to sleep at the end. You can go to bed. You'll have a good night's sleep at the end because you bored yourself to sleep before you
I'll give my order here. I'll give my order. I'll tell you what.
Yeah. Actually, you go first because,
Oppenheimer would be terrible to go last because I've heard it just leaves you with kind of a feeling of absolute dread. So that would maybe be the one I see first. I obviously didn't see it first. I saw Mission Impossible first. I agree with Kenny seeing Mission Impossible first. Just get yourself pumped up. See some Tom Cruise flying around. If we're jumping onto a train, I'm not going to spoil things. Movie's great. You should go see it. That would be my first. Then I'm going to see Oppenheimer. I'm going to walk out of that theater like, oh my gosh, that was incredible. But now I feel like terrible. And then you're like, you know what? Time to see Barbie. Let's go home happy. You go in, you see Barbie. Just going from Oppenheimer to Barbie seems insane, but it seems like the correct way to do it. Like you, because I think Barbie will probably leave you feeling a lot better.
I'm now reconsidering because of the absolutely ridiculous takes Kenny had about Oppenheimer and his order. Because I had the same order as Kenny, because I think I'm just like, I don't know. This is how excited I am for Oppenheimer. Peyton, you're probably right. I will yield that you're probably right. You should probably see. I think Mission Impossible first is like, that's a good consensus. Fun little action movie. It's Tom Cruise blowing stuff up. We've seen it all before. And it's great every time. And yes, you should probably then see Oppenheimer and, you know, be all like dread and fearful and nervous and then see Barbie and cool down. I've got the opposite. For some reason, I want to watch Oppenheimer last because I just want to think. There's some like maybe distorted, twisted part of me that just wants to walk out of that theater and just, I want to fully be like in the mix of emotion that movie gives you. I don't know why. That's probably messed up and strange, but I've been so excited for this movie.
No one's gonna walk out and just be like, "Are humans doomed? Like, are we doomed?" I want to
experience that to its fullest extent, and then I don't want to have it just instantly gone away by the fun-loving, fuel ride that is Barbie, which I will enjoy. I know, but like, no, I don't know. I have like a strange order, but now I want to switch it because Kenny just said end the movie with boring so that you can go to sleep at night. Just make you tired.
That is outrageous, man. Yeah.
Maybe two and a half hours.
Oh, that's maybe why, but like, I want to see
hours are boring. And plus, Josh Peck is in this movie. You think he's? Can you just look at him and not just see Megan?
Oh,
I could just see him yelling Megan as the bomb goes off. Like
Door
with the star.
Huey from The Boys is in a trailer, and I was like, I literally when I was watching the trailer and saw Huey from The Boys, I was like, holy, was that Huey from The Boys? And rewinded like twice to see that. It kind of sucked me out, but doesn't matter. It's like a cool biopic that everyone says is really good, other than the attention span fried freaks on your TikTok feed that apparently can't watch anything longer than an hour.
Yeah, another thing that really popped out about this Barbie movie to me is that there's an actor in it named Kingsley Benadire. And he's the bad guy in Secret Invasion, the Marvel show on Disney Plus. And so he's like a doll in this movie. Mm-hmm. But in the Marvel TV show, he just murders people ruthlessly. And it's like they're coming out at the same time. And in the movie,
outrange.
In the TV show, he like just stretches his arm out like Groot and just like just jabs people in the neck and just takes them out. And then he's walking around like a Barbie doll in this Barbie movie and dances. Like, that's crazy.
That's incredible acting. I love when that happens, when you see like an actor you like in just completely different roles and you're like, I can't unsee this. It's like, oh my gosh, I had the good comparison. The guy that plays the evil dude. I lost it. I had a good comp. I forgot who I was thinking of. He's like Grog or something is his name, or just like Gore.
Gore.
Yeah. Who plays?
Speaking of Gore.
Oh, Christian Bale.
Yeah, seeing Christian Bale as Gore, and then I just think of him as like,
Batman.
Batman. Psycho. Yeah. But I guess because he's in American Psycho. Oh, look at the YouTube.
It's Gore.
Kenny has a Gore Lego Gore.
Kenny's a big Lego Marvel guy.
Yeah.
And big Lego Star Wars guy.
I respect the Lego grind. I wish I got on it.
He looks a lot cooler in the movie. I don't think they did him justice. He kind of looks like a zombie here. Well, not a zombie, but a mummy.
He does look like a mummy. That's a good comment.
I just think of Batman Christian Bale. But I guess he is an American Psycho, and he plays like a twisted character in that too. But Kenny's doing the face.
Let's see Paul Allen's biopic.
I'm looking at Kingsley Benadire's other roles he's had. In his next role, he's playing Bob Marley in Bob Marley One Love. He played played one of the Kens in Barbie, and he also played Malcolm X. So he's had some really good roles recently.
Does a lot of, he likes biopics, it seems like.
Yeah.
If he did Malcolm X and he's doing
and Barbie.
Mm-hmm.
And Barbie is definitely a biopic. I guess about a doll. Does that count?
Like Barbie also, like, there's just a who's who cast. That and Oppenheimer just have like, oh my gosh, like, look at, I know everybody. Who that is. And it seems like Barbie was a ton of fun for people to shoot. So I don't know.
Yeah. I'm excited for all three. Mm-hmm. Kenny, you're not boring, but your take is wrong.
What time do movie theaters open on Mondays these days?
Are you seriously going to just try and watch all three?
I'm going to try and watch all three tomorrow.
I'd be in a buttered popcorn.
I really want to watch. I would love to watch Kenny attempt to sneak in three piping hot coffees into a movie theater, like under his coat.
I'm pretty sure you could
see what happened. Oh yeah, I guess they probably have coffee. You need to sneak them in because of your take. You need to sneak them in.
All right, I'm looking at the Edwards Theater near me, trying to find some more.
And where is that?
On this. Where's the address? 76. Just joking. Not going to dox this movie theater.
But
I'm trying to figure out when this opens. There's just no hours. Okay.
That means it's open 24 hours.
Monday. Oh, the first movies are like 7 o'clock. Who the hell is going to a movie at 7 o'clock? Ooh, 11.
I don't know. You suggested 8 a.m.
Oh, yeah. So 10:40 a.m. for 2D Oppenheimer. But I heard you have to see it in 4D.
You can't see.
You got to see it in 7 millimeters.
If you saw it in IMAX. 4D, if you feel saw the that bomb. Movie in 4D, you'd be blown up.
Yeah, you'd be dead.
All right, so I'm going to start it off. I said Mission Impossible first, so I can see Mission Impossible starting at 10:30 a.m. on Monday. We're going to follow that one
Can
up
you please do this and vlog it? This will be great content.
Mm-hmm. I can't vlog the actual movie. It's illegal.
Why would I? Never mind. You just suggested doing that. You suggested watching pirated movies during other movies.
There's a random movie tomorrow for $5 at 7:24.
Sounds so terrible. I would never
random
ever
move. Yeah.
All right. So how long did I say it was? About 2 hours. So then I could watch Barbie at 1:35 p.m. in just regular 2D.
Mission Impossible was like a 3 hour from sit down to leave experience for me.
Okay, so that could give me enough time. 1:35.
I'm just giving you you could right, definitely
include like did that include like previews?
Yes, that includes previews.
Oh, well, yeah.
Okay. So then I could say Oppenheimer at 6, and I'm home by 10.
You're probably not home by 10 after Oppenheimer.
If you're not falling asleep,
I'll be
in the theater.
I'll be asleep in my seat.
Because you're
I this
bored,
is
apparently.
Worst take.
Terrible.
Ever.
Oh,
I haven't even
such a bad
seen
take.
The movie.
I
just know this take stinks. Like,
I'm
going to
do this next Sunday. Actually, I'm going to include the Teenage Mutant Ninja Turtles movie in this as well. It comes out July 29th,
that's
the next
fourth.
Saturday.
That's fourth.
Yeah,
I would rather. I probably won't see.
I would rather. I would rather admit Oppenheimer is boring before I saw the Teenage Mutant Ninja Turtle movie.
That's the movie I'm going to watch while I'm scrolling on my phone mindlessly. That's like the one I'm just going to be doing at the same time.
While he's watching TikToks about Oppenheimer being boring.
Mm-hmm. Actually, someone's going to hold a game of Temple Run underneath
Subway
it.
Surfers underneath it.
So I can pay attention.
That's the future of cinema. It's all on It's all on Hulu, and it just has games, mobile games on in the bottom.
Random movie that Regal's doing is an hour and 44 minutes, and that's none of the movies that are actually out right now.
Do people actually like doing that? Just a
that
random movie?
That sounds kind of terrible. I'm not going to lie.
Movie heads probably like it. But
so this is the thing. So it starts at 7, so you got to like time it up with another movie that might be starting around 7, and if it's not the movie you like, just jump to the other one like this. Barbie starts at 7:15. You can jump over to that one.
Oh, okay. That's kind of cool, I guess.
Okay.
Yeah. I'm so excited for Oppenheimer. I'm so excited to. I might send a paragraph to Kenny about why his take is bad after I watch it.
I'm like 99% sure I'm going to love it.
Yeah. If I don't, I don't know.
Won't text Kenny.
Yeah, then I just won't say anything. He'll be like, how is the movie? I'll just send nothing.
But yeah.
Nice. Yeah. All right. Good movie segment. Got way more contentious than I thought, but Kenny came in hot with that.
Everyone's going to agree with me.
Kenny,
people agree with you
that actually see the movie are going to agree.
People
with
who
that.
Think Oppenheimer's boring think X is a good name for changing Twitter to.
X is a good movie. Yes.
not a good movie.
I have people that message me and say, you know, good takes, you know, the hot dog
Nobody
stuff.
You have people
no,
message
no, no,
you
no.
that say good takes?
No, the stuff about the hot dogs that you guys were talking about, how you guys cook hot dogs in microwaves, they thought you guys were nasty. That's kind of slimy and
I
gross.
I didn't say it was my go-to.
You said you would do it, though, and I had people text
if
me
I had
after
to.
And say, they were like, no, we would never do that because that's gross.
All right, let's end the show.
If Oppenheimer isn't boring, Kenny has to eat a microwaved hot dog on the show. I don't know. I was trying to connect.
Okay, how can you dictate that? There's a factual, like the historical error in this movie. They have the wrong American flags. I don't know how you guys are going to think this is good. If you didn't know Christopher Nolan made this movie, you would just be like, meh.
That's not true at all. But I do
not
like Christopher Nolan.
Not true.
That's I think
true.
It's true.
Not true
That's
at
not
all.
True. Boo.
We'll see.
Boo.
We'll see. I'm watching
Tenet
all three tomorrow.
Was
so
kind of lame because I didn't get it. But
Tenet's confusing.
Isn't yeah, because it goes back and forth. So
yeah. But anyways.
You're right. Well, yeah, good movie segment. Shout out Gore. Shout out Oppenheimer. I can't wait to brag in Kenny's face how good it is next show. So stay tuned for that. We're doing a brief movie recap after we see at least some of these if we're going in the next couple days before Friday's show.
I'm going on. I'm not going before Friday.
Oh, I'm going. Okay, like, fine. I'll do it. I'm going to Oppenheimer tomorrow, and I will brag to Kenny's face how good it is when next show.
It's going to be like a $45 trip just for tickets. I mean, movie tickets don't come cheap these days, especially in the big city.
I got a plug.
$8.
I got a plug. That's I got someone who works at the cinema. Nice. He gets me in for free.
Really?
Yeah. I got a guy.
I could go see movies for free. I would no joke.
I might just get the
movie pass. I like movies.
Yeah. Yeah. So. Shout out my guy, Frank. He hooks me up with free movie tickets. All right. Good show, everybody. Go see Oppenheimer and go get in Kenny's mentions of how good it is. Thank you for listening or watching. Go watch on the YouTube. Go follow us on TikTok. We just changed the name to a much better one. Follow us on Twitter and have a good, fun, and safe
week.
See you Friday.